Welcome to Seville, famous for its fiery flamenco dancing and rich Moorish heritage. This Andalusian gem is unmissable when visiting southern Spain. Join me to discover the splendors of this vibrant city as we explore some of the best sights of Seville and learn about its rich history. Let's go, vamos! Hola fellow travelers, Ken here from Ken Travels 360. If you're new to this channel, I love traveling and cruising, and I share useful tips I discovered during my travels, along with honest reviews of flights and cruises. This weekend, we're heading to Seville for a winter sunny city break. Yesterday, we had a day trip to the picturesque city of Cadiz, and I covered that in the link video, so check it out if you're interested. Today, in this video, we are going to explore some of the most important and most iconic attractions of Seville, and along the way, we'll learn about the rich history and vibrant culture that this Andalusian gem has to offer. We'll begin our tour at Real Alcázar. Let's rewind the clock to the 10th century. Seville had been under Moorish rule for a couple of centuries. In the year 913, the construction of a fortress that would later become the Alcázar was started. Initially, it was conceived as a military stronghold and residence for the governors. As Seville thrived under Moorish rule, the Alcázar underwent expansions and enhancements. The fortress evolved beyond its military functions and began to incorporate elements of palatial architecture. Moorish influences adorned its structure with horseshoe arches, intricate tilework, and mesmerizing geometric patterns. In 1248, the Christian forces led by King Fernando III successfully reclaimed Seville during the Reconquista, capturing the Iberian Peninsula for Muslim rule. Under Christian rule, the Alcázar underwent significant reconstruction and modification, and most of the Islamic era structure disappeared. During the reign of King Pedro I, from 1350 to 1369, he embarked upon a complete rebuilding of the palace. What you now see is actually a rebuild of the Alcázar in Mudéjar style. He wanted to build a beautiful palace that blended Moorish, Gothic, Renaissance, and later Mudéjar style. This blending of architectural influences resulted in the unique and visually stunning characteristics of the Alcázar. To visit the Real Alcázar, I highly recommend buying the tickets from the official website before your trip. To avoid overcrowding, the number of tickets are limited, so it makes sense to purchase the tickets in advance. Plus, you get to avoid the long queue at the ticket office. You enter the Real Alcázar via the Puerta de León, or the Lion's Gate. This gate leads to the Patio de León, the Lion's Courtyard. This was where King Pedro used to give his judgments. Before we get into the palace of Pedro I, we'll check out this Salón del Almirante, or the Admiral's Hall. This used to house the Casa de las Contrataciones, an institution founded by Queen Isabel I after the discovery of America to control the trade between Spain and the New World. Queen Isabel I tried to build a more European-style wing, but the overall style doesn't really integrate well with the rest of the Alcázar. Many of the early voyages would have been planned in this room, Cuatro del Almirante. Next to it is the Sala del Audiencias, also known as the Capilla de los Navigantes. It has an artesonado ceiling inlaid with golden rosettes. Inside, there's a beautiful painting by Alejo Fernandez from the early 16th century. It shows the Virgin of the Navigators protecting explorers and their ships. The details are so clear that naval historians find it really helpful. The painting includes Columbus wearing gold and the Pinzon brothers who sail with him. King Carlos V in a red cloak stand under the Virgin. In the back on the left are the kneeling Indians who had the dubious blessing of Christianity that had been brought by the Spanish conquest. The artwork reflects the belief that at the time, Spain has a special mission from God. Next, we'll visit the palace of Pedro I. There are two major highlights here. The first highlight is the Patio de las Doncellas, or the Patio of the Maidens. The name refers to an old tradition where Christians presented 100 virgins annually to the Moorish kings. The heart of the patio has been restored to its original 14th century state after being hidden under tiles for four centuries. The court features beautifully crafted elements such as a plaster frieze, a dado made of colorful azulejos, and doors showcasing the finest Granada craftsmanship. Notice the unique architectural plan here, Mudéjar style on the lower level and the Renaissance style on the upper level, including those double columns. While the room is decorated in a Muslim style, the actual ornamentation is Christian and European, as you can see symbols of kings, animals, and buildings. Images are forbidden in Islam. Well, next, we have the most stunning room of the whole Alcázar, Salón del Embajadores, the Salon of Ambassadors. It features a fantastic wooden dome with red, green, and gold patterns and horseshoe arches inspired by the palace of Medina Azahara near Córdoba. The inscription says it was built by craftsmen from Toledo and finished in 1366. Moving past the fancy Salón de Embajadores, we reach the last grand room in the palace, the Patio de las Muñezas, or the Patio of the Dolls. This was the king's living quarters. It gets its quirky name from the two tiny faces on one of the smallest arches. This place is thought to be where the haram used to be in the original palace. After checking out all the highlights, we stroll through the gardens, admiring the fountains and orange trees. Overall, Real Alcázar is definitely a must-see in Seville, and I highly recommend booking your tickets online in advance. For the best experience with fewest crowds, consider securing the earliest available time slot. As the day progresses, the attraction tends to get quite crowded with tourists. Our next stop is the Seville Cathedral, whose history is intricately interwoven with the broader history of Seville. The origins of this iconic structure dates back to the 12th century, when the Almohad Mosque, or the Great Mosque of Seville, was constructed. Back in 712 AD, the city was conquered by the Moors and it flourished as a stronghold under Moorish rule. Fast forward to 1248, Seville was reclaimed by Christian forces during the Reconquista by King Fernando I. That marked a turning point in the city's history. The new rulers faced the question of what to do with the mosque. Rather than demolishing it entirely, which was a common practice during that period, a decision was made to repurpose the mosque into a cathedral, and they consecrated it to Virgin Mary. In 1356, an earthquake caused significant damage, so that eventually, in 1401, the church authorities decided to demolish the old structure and rebuild a new spectacular one. Legend has it that they exclaimed that, "Let's construct a church on so magnificent a scale that future generations will believe we were mad." The result is the staggering cathedral behind me. It was thought to be the third largest church in the world, after St. Paul's in London and St. Peter's in Rome. The only structure that was kept was the minaret, which was converted into the bell tower of the new cathedral and is now known as the La Giralda, named after its weathered vane as its top. Inside the cathedral, there are a few important highlights. You will find the mausoleum of Christopher Columbus. His remains were transferred from Cuba to Seville and now rest in this tomb. It's adorned with a bronze coffin carried by four figures symbolizing the kingdoms of Castile, Leon, Aragon, and Navarre. Another highlight is the Capilla Real, the royal chapel, and it's built on the site of the original royal burial chapel.
It was here that Ferdinand III, the king who reclaimed Seville from the Moors in the Reconquista in 1248, as well as several other members of the Spanish monarchy, were buried. You can also climb up the minaret of the cathedral, La Giralda. You'll get a great view over the city center when you're at the top of the 104-meter-high tower. After visiting the cathedral, check out the nearby Archivo General de Indias, housed in a magnificent building that used to be the merchant's commodity exchange. The interior of the building is visually stunning. Look at this grand staircase in pink and black marble, and these bookcases in Cuban wood. The archive contains an incredible collection of documents from the Spanish Empire's colonial period, including maps and administrative records. I think this might be just empty cardboard boxes. If you've been enjoying this video, I would kindly ask you to give this video a thumbs up. And please consider subscribing to this channel with the notification bell. This way, you'll be notified whenever I release a new video. Next, we're here to explore the stunning Plaza de España. This massive semicircular plaza was designed to be the centerpiece of the Ibero-American Fair in 1929. That's kind of like the World Expo. The goal of the exhibition was partly to make symbolic peace with its former colonies in Latin America, and partly to stimulate the local and national economy, which was still recovering from the effects of the First World War, and finally, also to promote the city. Unfortunately, that coincided with the Wall Street crash and the onset of the Great Depression, so the fair left the city with a substantial debt. But this beautiful square remains. With a diameter of 200 meters, it was designed by architect Anibal Gonzalez in Spanish Renaissance style. Two towers flank the plaza, along with fountains. Here, fountains and majestic stairways. The four bridges in the square represent the first four kingdoms of Spain: Castile, León, Aragon, and Navarra. Each one is adorned with a unique ceramic decoration and is shielded at the highest point of the bridge. There's a canal that runs through the middle, and you can actually rent a boat here to row around the canal. Around the crescent, you will find 52 benches and mosaics of azulejo tiles, each depicting a Spanish province. This is why this square is called Plaza de España, as each province is represented here. After soaking in the grandeur of Plaza de España, it's almost time for dinner. We'll now head to the center of the old town. But before dinner, we have one more attraction to visit, a relatively new addition to Seville. Okay. Well, we're here at Cetus de Sevilla at night. The Metropole Parasol, commonly known as Cetus de Sevilla, which means Seville mushrooms, was built as part of the urban redevelopment of the Plaza de la Encarnación. The goal was to revitalize the square, create a modern architectural landmark, and provide new facilities for public use. Designed by architect Jürgen Meyer, the structure consists of a series of striking wooden parasols that form a distinctive canopy. Locals lovingly call it Las Setas, or the mushrooms, because of their shapes. Their design is not just for show. They provide shade during the day and illuminate beautifully at night, creating a magical atmosphere in the heart of the city. And you can even buy a ticket to get on the walkway that runs over them, culminating in a viewing platform. But this evening, we're having tapas at this tapas bar called Alfalfa 8, or Alfalfa 8. Alright, we have just ordered our tapas. Let's have some beer. Cheers. Right, the first tapas has arrived. It's the chicken wings, I think. Chicken sticks.
drumsticks.
The next tapas has arrived is this prawns croquette.
Our next dish has arrived is a boletus risotto. That means mushroom risotto, really. Let me show you.
Well, our last tapas has arrived. Guess what it is? It's the ribs. They're really good.
I hope you've enjoyed this tour of Seville. For a lot of people visiting Seville, Cadiz is actually a great day trip option. To find out what you will see on a day trip there, watch this video next. See you over there. Hasta la vista. This Andalusian gem is unmissable when visiting southern France. Join me.
Right, so next pass. Yeah, not pass there. The next tapas.